Welcome to the CQN Podcast, A Celtic State of Mind. I'm Paul John Dykes, and this week Kevin Graham and I are joined by the man who scored the winning goal in the 1985 Scottish Cup final, Frank McGarvey. Now, Frank was a hard-working, prolific striker who partnered such names as Charlie Nicholas, George McCluskey, Brian McClare, and that wee shit Maurice Johnston at Celtic Park from 1980 to 1985. I invited Frank to a Celtic State of Mind's first live event, which took place at the penalty spot on Sword Street in Glasgow, and you can still listen to the first two parts of this event with Tommy Sheridan and John Fallon by searching for the podcast on iTunes, Spreaker or any other podcast player. Frank chats about his time at Liverpool, signing for Celtic, his admiration for Jock Stein, his partnership with Charlie Nicholas, the 1985 Scottish Cup final, why this was his final appearance in the hoops, and of course, Love Street 1986. And there are also a few disagreements between Frank and John Fallon, who was a fellow guest at the event, that you won't want to miss. This interview was done in front of a live audience, and because of this, there is some background noise and mobile interference. Hopefully this doesn't stop you from enjoying the show. Here is Frank McGarvey with A Celtic State of Mind. Frank, I met you at the Neil and Walken night.
Yeah,
at Celtic Park.
That.
It was lovely for you to come along. Unfortunately, I never got a chance to speak to you before the book, but young Neely informed me that his dad was very fond of you.
Yeah.
What was your memories of Neely?
My memories of Neely, one of the worst memories I had of Neely, Neely liked a bet, and I used to do a wee Yankee before the game, you know, maybe 1 o'clock, the game starts at 3 o'clock, and I would always say to Neely, check the event, because I was in getting and I had three up, and Neely came in, and it was about 2 o'clock, the fourth race, and it was over, and he went out and watched it, and I was waiting for a ride for you, Bob, and I said, how did that horse go? And he said it was last. I was like, banned, it was last. I won the race, but Neely didn't want to tell me that he'd won. He wanted to put me down. He couldn't help it, you know. One guy went around, he just was like that. He says, no, I get beat. And then after that, I went up to get my money. I said, I've only got a few hundred quid here. And I got a lot of money, and I was like, banned it. I go home on Monday. So it was that was his sense of humour. And he was a brilliant person for the dressing room. Anybody came in there weak at all, I remember Jim Melrose coming in and going, Neely, I need help and all that, and behind me, not, and that was a sign of weakness, and Neely used to slaughter them all the time, and Jim Melrose never lasted long, because Neely, in the dressing room, would get these players that were weak, and, you know, if they couldn't handle Neely, they had no chance, and Jim Melrose couldn't handle Neely Malkin, and that's how he left.
You think it was because Neely had that knowledge as an ex-player, what was required, the kind of metal you had to have to be a success at Celtic Park?
He knew exactly what kind of player you had to be, what kind of character you had to be to play, especially up front at Parkhead. And if you weren't up to it, Neely let you know in front of other players in the dressing room. It wouldn't go anywhere outside. In that dressing room, Neely would come in and he'd all these wee comments he would make. But Neely Malkin, he must have been some centre forward as well. I've seen a few of his goals, but he must have been some player as well, because he knew everything about how to score goals and how to play up front and how to attract the fans and all that. He knew everything. And then I scored three goals one day against St Mirren. Actually, I scored about six or seven of the chances I had that day. And Neely says to me, you're the real deal. And that was probably the best thing he ever said to me. He said to me that day, shook my hand and said, you're the real deal. And that really gave me a lot of confidence. So that for him to, because I respected him completely and the players loved him in the dressing room. He was great for the dressing room.
When you were a new player coming into that dressing room and a big signing, big money signing, how did he test you? How did he test your mettle?
Well, he would come in and I was fortunate. I was very fortunate to play in a Celtic team where I had guys like Paul McStay, David Proven, Roy Aiken made me a lot of goals. I was fortunate. If you're a centre forward and you've not got a lot of guys that can make goals for you, then you're going to struggle a wee bit more. I was very fortunate. In my first game against St Mirren, I had a nightmare because I was just signed that day, really. But Desmond White wanted me to play to get the crowd. There was going to be an extra few thousand people coming, so he wanted the extra money in. In the second game, I scored against Hibs, and then my third game, I wasn't playing very well. I scored one goal in two games, but I wasn't playing well because I was came to Liverpool, second team in the Celtic first team, which playing for Liverpool second team is easy, and there wasn't a lot of pressure on you. And I wasn't as fit as what I should have been, and I knew all that. And with the play Rangers, with the beat them that night, they had a good chance of winning the league. And my dream was always, you know, to play against Rangers, 2 minutes to go, and I would score the winner. And I was in the McDonald Hotel that night, and all my pals, Feaster House and Ballonock and the boys from St Mirren came up to the hotel that night. There was mobbed before the game, and I went away. And they door backed me to score the first goal and Celtic to win and all that. And I said, I never bet in football. And I was like, I had to go away because the pressure was on me. But 2 minutes to go, Roy Aiken ran down the left side, backheeled it, crossed it over, and I headed it in. And I always headed it down the way against Peter McCloy because Peter McCloy was that tall, he couldn't get down to anything. And after the game, I had to do it, and Big Bully said after the game, well done, and I scored the one and all that. It was fantastic for me, and I got me off the hook a wee bit with the fans. And after the game, Big Bully said, it wasn't a great either, Frank. And I said, well, none of the net, and all the boys were laughing. And then Big Bully, he was happy I scored now. I loved Big Bully, and he loved me at the time, and it was great. We were going brilliant with him, and the next day he came in, he said, sorry Frank, in front of all the players, he said, sorry Frank, he said, I made a mistake last night. That was a brilliant header, and McCloy had no chance of saving that. He said that was brilliant in front of all the players, and right away I had respect. He made a wee mistake, but he confirmed it to the players, and that was fantastic. But I never started well at Celtic. That from March to May, I never really started well.
I think that was just you coming back to speed after maybe playing in the second team down at Anfield.
Well, I was playing the second team, and we were playing the second team, and we went to play Manchester United's second team one day, and we were running 6-0 after an hour. We were that good. The team I had in. On the Liverpool midfield was Sammy Lee, Kevin Sheedy and Ronnie Whelan. And up front was me, David Fairclough, and a guy, Howard Gale, the fastest winger that's ever lived on planet Earth. But he couldn't cross the ball to you. I said, that's fantastic, and by all the guys, I need the ball played in front of me. Played the ball behind me, too high, big high ball. I said, and I need to see Bob Paisley one day. I need to see him one day as well, because I was the top goal scorer for the second team. I said, that Howard Gale's. I would play, but he's not making me any goals. I said, and anyway, why am I still in the second team? I still want all these goals. He said, I've not got a third team, Frank.
when you came back up the road to sign for Celtic, did Paisley make any attempt to keep you?
None at all. Liverpool's having any. But what happened was, we played Ipswich on the Saturday. And so David Johnson was injured, so I said, I must be playing. I scored 25 goals for the second team. David Fairclough scored 10. I said, that must be my chance. But they had a great system. David Fairclough was next, and I was after him. So I went in, and I was sub. I thought I was playing against Ipswich, because David Johnson, who had scored 39 goals that season for Liverpool. That's how difficult it was, and Kenny Dalglish was the other centre forward. That's how difficult it was for me. But Liverpool had this great thing. They would make sure they had a strong second team, and that kept the first team motivated, because they all had to play well. We had some players in that, and Grzegovic in goals, and Javi Corn left. We had some team. What a team that would have been into any other, that could have went into the league and been in top four or five.
And you mentioned Sheedy and Sammy Lee there in the middle of the park, two fantastic.
Ronnie Whelan
as well, right?
Ronnie Whelan was some player, you know what I mean? We had some, I'd playing with great players. What was the question you asked again about
did Paisley make any attempt to keep you?
I went in and I said to him, I should have been playing. I never said in the Saturday, I went in the Monday morning and I said, this was March, I said to Bob Paisley, I said, well, I'm scoring all these goals and you played David Fitcliffe in front of me. He said, you'll get a chance, Frank. When you do get a chance, you're going to get five or six games. It's not just one game you get. You get five, so this is the system we've got. You'll get five or six games. He said, you'll get your chance within the next year. He said, that'll come up. And I said, well, I said, I'm not waiting another year. I said, I'm not the same player I was last year. And I said, I'm playing for the second team. I'm up against 500 people at Anfield on a Saturday. I said, that's not for me. I would rather wait out. He said to me that, Frank, we don't keep players at the club that are not happy. I said, well, I'm not happy and I would like to go. And he said, that's okay, you're free to go. And they sold me, and a few weeks later brought Ian Rush. So they knew things. And I didn't fit in at Liverpool. I was unhappy. I had a beautiful house down in Formby. Ken DeLeese just lived a few miles up the road, played golf with him. And that was something else that I didn't understand with Bob Paisley. He said, you're not allowed to play golf. And I like to game of golf once a week. I said, well, why is Ken DeLeese half six and Alan Hansen's half eight? And he couldn't answer me. But anyway, Liverpool were a brilliant club. I could never give them any stick. For the chairman, right down to the cleaners, they were all the same, and I loved that. And that's happening at St Mirren just now. I mean, you're down to St Mirren a lot, and that's happening there just now. Something's happening there, so it is. And it's exact. They're doing it the exact same way as Liverpool done it, and that's the way to do it, where nobody's away above anybody else. And Liverpool had that. The chairman, the whole club was fantastically run, and I could see why they were winning European Cups every year. You know what I mean? They were a brilliant club, brilliant to watch. So they had a. I just didn't fit in. I was never going to fit in, and I left. And Alec Ferguson was on the phone to me right away for Aberdeen, and I was 50-50 way going to Aberdeen and Celtic. I know you probably think, oh, you should have went to Celtic, but Alec Ferguson was good for me as a man. And I knew Aberdeen had a much better defence than Celtic, with Wally Muller and McLeish and all that, and Jim Leighton. But Celtic defence, I said, well, that's a Celtic thing, you know. The one thing Celtic have never done is go and buy expensive centre-halves and expensive defenders, and that's been Celtic's fault long. Even now, they'll not go and buy themselves centre-halves. They've never done it in my time. The Lisbon Lions, you know, they were attacking all the time. That's the best form of defence, John, isn't it? So you hardly had to defend, you know what I mean?
Good centre-halves.
Yeah?
We had great centre-halves.
I think John Clark is the most underestimated football player that's ever played for Celtic. He was a genius.
You know, at the time, he had two centre-backs, couldn't even play, were playing the right half. John McNamee was a great centre-half. Well, McNamee had things that Billy didn't have. McNamee could tackle and win a ball, you know, on the ground, it was good. You know, Billy was brilliant in the air. He commanded. But there are other players, you know, a different style. Big Cushy was just a bomber, you know. Big Cushy was strong as well, but John McNamee, well, John fell out. He was shipped out to Hibs. You know, we did some good teams, you know. We had a system that, Frank's talking about a system, we had that system for years at Parkhead, and it was broke up too early. Two teams, they broke up, as I already said, we broke up two teams far too early.
Yeah. Celtic done no bad at the time. They got another European Cup final. They were getting into four semis
as well.
Well, you know, that is, you know, that's up there with anything Celtic's ever done in their history. So you can't bring that down. That is up there.
No, but the man changed the team too quick.
He was still getting into European Cup finals. He couldn't have done that much wrong. That's what I'm saying.
After that.
But, you know, he's getting into all the Cup finals. That's genius. Jock Stein, I know some players don't like him and all that, but the guy is a genius. What he done for Celtic will never be repeated again.
Well, Frank, I'll tell you when it started, 58. It started way back in 1958.
I thought it started in 65.
No, it started in 58.
When he won the Cup.
No, it started in 58 when the Kelly Babes was brought in, and with a nucleus of that team.
But you never done it in these 7 years?
No. I was playing with Neely Morgan. I was playing the first team with Neely Morgan, Bobby Evans, Bertie Peacock, John Corain, different players. You know,
and if you got
no, wait a minute. But if you got three, we go to a semi final in 1963, 64, and through stupidity, we should have argued instead of bombing it against MTK, we could have played in the European Cup then, Cup Winners' Cup. We had a couple of good runs then as well. But we learnt. So that team had learnt for this through myself, Big Billy, John Clark, Bobby Murdoch, all that, they learnt.
Good experience,
and then we came. Jock left when we were winning trebles in the reserves. Way back in the 60s, 59, 60s, we were winning. Jock went away to Dunfermline. We sort of got into a slump because we were in and out of the team, as you said, four or five games. That's why we were brought in. You were allowed in five times, maybe six games. And then you'd be out again, and then you'd be brought in again. You'd get plenty of experience. But when Jock went away, it seemed to be, well, we'll just keep going to this system. But when Jock came back, we knew right away. Jock's first game, I think, one of his first games, I remember, we got slaughtered at Celtic Park against Hibs. We had just left. 4-0, a Wednesday night. Slaughtered us. And we went into the dressing room after the game and said, oh, we're going to get slaughtered here. He's going to go through us. And he turned around and he looked at us all, and he says, see that out there? That's the way you will be playing next week. In a full week, we went back to our old system.
Is this the system you were playing in the reserves?
Yes, as it boys. It was the same nucleus of the team. If you look at our young team, and then look at the team that won the cup, not very many changes. Jock Stein never signed Bertie. He chased Ronnie Simpson, for Hibs. But that nucleus of that team came up, and that's the team that won the cup in 65. And for then on, it was very lucky. If you look at the history of the team, the names of...
Do you think
your
manager came in then?
No. Big Joe came back and he put us back to the system that we were used to playing him.
Right.
Because we were getting tell the day this, tell the day that. And you couldn't argue because we knew the system that we'd already been taught and we went back to that teaching. When Joe came, that was us. As I tell you, we got beat Hibs for. Hibs destroyed us. And 2 weeks later, we went to Easter Road and blew them out of the park.
Why was that?
Because we'd 2 weeks together. Working, 2 weeks together, working out, back to our system. As soon as you had that, you knew everything that was done. He brought the players in.
Some improvement in 2 weeks.
But because we knew what was happening. We had the confidence, and he made you believe in what you done. Even though he maybe not like you, but he used you to make, you could do that job, that job. That was all he was looking for.
So what he done, he came back to a system.
He came back to a 4-4-2.
But do you think
a 4-3-3?
Do you think Jock made the difference?
He was taught by Herrera.
Jock, I watched the documentation. I watched a big program with Jock Stein there. From the '50s, he always went with other managers and spoke about the game. He gave his whole life to football, and he would talk to everybody, Herrera and all these people.
No, he was invited by Herrera.
Aye, well, that's brilliant. And but what I'm saying is,
him and Wally Waddle went out at that time. Wally Waddle was with Kilmarnock at the time.
They done well as well, Rangers, at that time.
Not Kilmarnock.
Kilmarnock as well.
And that was the two top teams. But we went back to a system that we all knew. And you work on it for 2 weeks, you can have a great system at back. You knew what you did today and everybody was happy. That's the thing.
Can you answer me one thing that I've asked all the Lisbon Lions and not one of them have given me an answer? Not one of them. I went out for a meal with Jim Craig last week and he couldn't answer me. You played about 65 games that season,
mm-hmm.
In 1967. We're a very extremely fit team. I found that puzzling, knowing a lot of the players. In the last game of the season, he's played in the European Cup final, which he should have been fatigued. The whole team should have been fatigued, especially about four or five of them. And yet, he's were the fittest team in planet Earth. In that day, after 65 games, why were you so fit in a warm country on that day?
Up there, we were never tired. We used to hate no having a game in midweek. We used to say to the boss, oh, there's no training all week, have we? So what did they do? He used to send us away a Wednesday night to East Stirling, Cowdenbeath, anywhere. Split the teams up and play keep you playing. Training, we didn't do an amount of training. You done all the training with a ball. That's the first thing you done. All your training was done with a ball. You ask a tennis player, what does he train with? Does he run round the park? Before that, we were all made run round the park. And when Jock came back, the first thing he done was brought a ball. That's Jim McCarthy, how he trained in England. Everything was done with a ball. You trained with a ball. You're a football player. You play with a ball. You don't do athletics. You don't do 410 and 420s and then four laps and then a mile. That's pre-season stuff. But once the season is, you play with a ball and you get the system. The system comes back to you.
You think and that's playing, what it was all up and up. Just playing with a ball all the time.
No, playing football. That. Playing football. You didn't get tired. It was a mental thing you had. That strength, mental strength you had. And I think that's what's lacked this season. The last month with us, we're still a fit team, but mentally, we're drained. Don't forget, Tom will tell you.
But these guys,
we went away back, we didn't have grass in the parks.
I'm watching.
We had muck. A fit deep and muck.
That was all part of the game. I'm watching a Sinclair, he's as fit a football player as you'll see. And he's round about.
You talk about the mental aspect. Do you think the mental aspect maybe come from two heavy defeats against PSG, then a poor performance against Anderlecht at home, where we basically hung on? Do you think that's maybe affected some of the players' confidence, and now they're going out against teams that last season were completely dominating, and this is playing in the back of their mind? There's some of them that were maybe looking to move on, thought they were better players than what's been proved over the last 6-7 weeks.
Go back to the Rangers game. It wasn't long started, and what do you call him, Brownie, Scott Brown, put the marker down.
He did,
but nobody followed him.
Aye.
Against Hearts, he put the marker down. Nobody followed him. He puts down the marker.
He's quite good at doing that if we're under the cost.
We'd Bobby. We'd Bobby Murder could put the marker down. You'd be Bertie who could put the marker down in different ways. Your Big Tam could do it. You know, Big Tam was a great fullback going forward, but no for defending. He couldn't defend. That's where John Clark came in. Just done the thing. You know, I talk about Beckenbauer. That's what John Clark done. He just swept behind. George Connolly done it. George Connolly done it in front and behind. You know, George could do it in midfield, just float about there. David Hay used to put the marker down. So everybody had that mental strength. You know, it was, and that's where where we won it. Mentally.
So your answer for that was, it was in their head.
No, you were mentally strong.
No, talking about the word, they were that fit because it was a mental thing.
No, you're mentally stronger.
Right, okay.
You didn't accept defeat.
I put all the answers down and I'll put your answer down.
You don't accept defeat. Never accept defeat. I think
I'm looking at it all and I'm thinking that he's won nearly every single game, and by winning you gain energy. I don't know where that energy comes from. It's the same as scoring a goal.
Mental strength.
It's the same as scoring a goal. You could be getting beat 1-0 against Rangers and then you score a goal. All of a sudden you've got all this extra strength. And I think that's why Celtic were so fit at the end of the season. After hearing everybody, I think just keep running and keep gathering strength by running and scoring goals. If you score a goal, you gather strength. It's an incredible thing. And it's something you can't answer. And I think that's why they were so fit at the end of the season.
Well, that's how you've done it. That's how the Invincible have done it. You were mentally fit.
I don't accept this. No, let me answer. I'll let you talk for 10 minutes there. Celtic are playing in a league where the second and third and fourth teams can't get into the Europa Cup league sections. Teams from Luxembourg are beating us, so the league is very, very weak. This Scottish league is very, very weak, and Celtic are a half decent team. Ryan, isn't it?
Frank,
that's no Celtic's fault.
It's no Celtic's fault. And Celtic's helping Scottish football. We're getting into the Champions League stages, bringing money in, going to St Mirren and getting the wee boy Morgan in, getting him in, getting them money. Celtic are doing a lot of good in Scottish football financially because other clubs are benefiting them from Celtic with all this extra money coming in. So Celtic are doing brilliant.
Well, don't say that on Govan, because they've still to say thanks very much for the £600,000 they gave them.
Well, I'm not going to get into the Rangers thing. I'm here to talk about Celtic.
Aberdeen accepted it. Motherwell accepted it. Other teams say that's good.
Well, I'm saying it's good. Rangers. I'm saying it's good.
And you know, the EBT mob.
Well, I'm not going to get into all that. Oh, God, oh my.
No, but everybody says...
My mind will not go there. Let's
everybody said... It's funny. The media is the worst in this country. If it's the same... No, if it's a poor league when we played...
When?
When we played, it was a poor league. When
60s?
Aye.
The teams were getting into European Cup finals.
It was still
that's
a poor
how
league.
Measure. That's
it was still a poor league when we were 1-9 in a row. They didn't want us to be 1-9 in a row.
It's
still the same media than now.
Listen,
it's all about Rangers.
Teams in Scotland then were getting into European Cup finals and winning them. How is the league weak?
We were the only team that won the European Cup final.
They were getting into European Cup finals. And
Cup
winners,
Aberdeen.
Won
Aberdeen were a good
European
team.
And then the United get into a. That's what
yes,
I'm saying.
Aberdeen. Dundee United's
even
only.
Even the smaller teams, Dundee United are not a big team. They get into the final.
You played in the 80s, Frank. In the 80s, you had Aberdeen won the Cup Winners' Cup. Mm-hmm. Dundee United get to the UEFA, the UEFA Cup final in 1987. You also had Celtic, the Rapid Vienna affair, got to semi-final, the Cup Winners' Cup. Scotland at that time qualified for World Cups and that.
Continually.
So when you were playing on a weekly basis, you had to be mentally strong to go there and come up and get face guys who were fantastic football players week in, week out. Does that not make Celtic's achievement going that unbeaten run and what you call such a poor league show their mental strength? That the fact that they turned up week in, week out, and the first really horror show that they had was against Hearts a couple of weeks ago.
Well, I think football's all about consistency. If you're going to be a good player, you've got to be consistent. Celtic have been very consistent. You cannot take anything away by Brendan Rodgers or Celtic at all. I'm just stating the fact that the Scottish League is very poor just now. That's all I'm stating. And Celtic have went in that run because of that, and because they've got a good manager in and they're very consistent.
Lord, won't you give me the strength to be strong and be true? Lord, when the devil gets into my head, I'm so blue. Lord, won't you give me the strength to be strong and be true? You knock me, if you're so mighty, why waste your time with me? If I'm bad, ignorant and sad, why waste your time? You're mad. You're just mad because your life is sad. You've done nothing worthwhile. Twist a knife because you hate your life. My life you want to spoil. For me, I never will forget the suffering that my people went so cynical. Jesus, wake up and live. Your bad vibe will drive away your tribe. And where will you be then? All alone, heart that's cold as stone, hurting yourself again.
Celtic in Europe, and you see how we've ended up in the Champions League this year. Probably we ended up fortunate to finish third, because if Anderlecht probably would have had a manager in place, we might have finished bottom of the group. When you look back at last season, we had great performances against Man City and Borussia Mönchengladbach. When you look at the qualifiers, you look at the teams that we qualify against, for me, it pains me to say it, but that's our level. We're at Astana's level, we're at Beersheva's level. You're talking about Celtic's journey to be at that level has been a number of years, number of heartaches, your Malmos, your Maribors and that. As you quite rightly say, Scottish clubs are not doing well in Europe. Is it because Europe's maybe getting better?
I don't think so. I think Scottish football in the early 80s, the first bad mistake Scottish football made in the early 80s was, I played with a lot of managers, street football, school football, none of them had coaching badges or anything. They had nothing. Half of them couldn't even kick their backside, but they were brilliant at getting the teams out, they were brilliant at getting leagues formed, they were brilliant at getting people playing football against each other. These guys were brilliant. Some of them were very good at football, some of them weren't. The early 80s, they weren't like that. If you've not got a badge, you can't be a manager of a football club. And that sent thousands of people out of football at that time in the early 80s, which is never said. I'm amazed that this is never said. These thousands of people went out of football, and then from then on there weren't as many young football teams, and you weren't allowed to sign for a team till you were 16 as well. Now they're signing players at 11 and telling them at 12 you're not good enough. That boy just signed for Celtic. Rangers let him go. And you can't do that. You've got to let the kids enjoy the football, get all the guys back. You don't need a badge. Get them all back and you can get in and organise football games again. That said, all the guys, since then, Scottish football's gradually been down the way. And the people that be in Scottish football, that are running Scottish football, really have not got a clue how to fix it.
We're in the middle of Project Brave, and that was going to be my next comment. Nobody seems to understand. That's Malky Mackay's.
Is it his? Or is it
Malky Mackay's blueprint to revolutionise Scottish football, or the youth system in Scottish football? We recently had Falkirk, whose youth academy's kept the club going for the last five, six seasons. They're scrapping it at the end of this. They've scrapped it.
No, the only
in January, they actually scrapped their youth academy. You mentioned St Mirren. Now, over the last couple of years, St Mirren have had Stevie Mallon. They've had Lewis Morgan recently joined us. You're saying that St Mirren have now got the same sort of mentality that you're seeing when you went to Liverpool. Do you think that Do you think that's right? Do you think that's the way clubs should be going? Is the way Celtic should be going?
What?
Like, for the top down, create your own.
Oh, you must create your own, if that helps me. But but to say that, I played in the East End of Glasgow I was in Easter House, played all my time in the East End of Glasgow, and Celtic never noticed me at all until I went to Liverpool. In St Mirren, a team for Paisley could see I was not a bad player, and they signed me.
So when you signed for Liverpool, I mean, you had 2 years at St Mirren, and you were quite a hot property in Scottish
Cup. I signed for Kilsyth Rangers. I was playing for Kilsyth Rangers, and I went down to get a trial with St Mirren. Alec Ferguson was the manager, and St Mirren said, we want to sign you, and they offered Kilsyth Rangers, we want £100 for me, and St Mirren were only, they only gave £75. I was getting a £25 signing on fee. I put that to £75 so St Mirren could sign me. But my only mistake I never made there, I should have had 25% of anything I was sold for, that should have been mine, because I paid £25 for that, and I would have received £85,000 when I went to Liverpool for done that.
So you're knocking the ball in the back of the net for St Mirren. How did the move to Liverpool come about? Was it Liverpool the only team that came in for you? I mean, obviously Liverpool...
Well, they were the European champions at the time, so I was quite happy they were the only team that came in for me.
I suppose, I.
Aberdeen tried to sign me, Alec Ferguson tried to sign me for St Mirren, but St Mirren at the time would not sell any of their players to a Scottish club, and Tony Fitzpatrick went to Bristol City just after me as well. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? So St Mirren made a good few bob out of that and done well out of that. But you've got to get the players, the young players, I think you've just got to get them playing football all the time, enjoying themselves. And don't tell any young boy at 12 you're not good enough. That's a disgrace.
Well, I think you look at the three hottest prospects in Scottish football at the moment. You had Andrew Robertson, who was let go by Celtic, went to Queen's Park, now had a man of the match performance last night in a Merseyside derby. You've had Kieran Tierney, who, if reports are to be believed, he was close to be getting let go by Celtic. He's also had two bad injuries in a short period of time, which I think's probably been character building for him. And you've got Lewis Morgan, who's also had that rejection. But understand where you're coming from, that if you're telling a 12-year-old laddie, no, you're no good enough, if he hasn't got the right support or another club takes him in, then that laddie could be lost to the game forever. You played in a Celtic team with Charlie Nicholas, who was probably the best prospect to come through for Celtic since Dalglish.
Yeah, no problem about that. No problem about that. And Charlie, I feel sorry. You know, a lot of Celtic supporters don't like Charlie, and that's up to them what they want to do. I know. But when Charlie was playing with me up front, he was scoring. He scored 53 goals. He scored 53 goals for Celtic. Every club in Europe wanted him. He said to me, he said, Frank, I said, I'm thinking of going to Liverpool. He said, all the top clubs are in for me. I said, well, if you go to Liverpool, you might have to sit in the second team for a while. But at that time, he was on £90 a week, Charlie. 53 goals, everybody in the world wanted to sign him. And they offered him, £300 a week. I was the top paid player at Celtic because I came to Liverpool. And that helped all the other players get up there. So they offered Charlie £330 a week plus £5,000 sign-on fee. Arsenal offered him £3,300 a week and £5,000 sign on fee. What Celtic fan would have said no to that? The silence completely gives him an answer. Right, yeah. Carry on.
As often says, you played with Nicholas. How did you and Charlie rebound off each other? There's a kind of saying that you don't know he's running for him.
No, but Charlie was good for me because it needed at least one guy to mark Charlie. Now I would go long. I watched Bobby Lennox and Stevie Chalmers, and that's how I played my game. I wanted to go long. I wanted to go in behind defences, but it took two defenders to cover me. So that left Charlie space. But then he would get the ball and turn. That team was in trouble. So it was a perfect match. Me and Charlie, we didn't really go on with each other off the park. You see, on the park, It was just a chemical thing between the two of us. He knew what I was doing. I would dummy a ball knowing he was there, then he would play me in again. But the only problem I had with Charlie, I made Charlie a lot more goals than Charlie made me. He was greedier than me. Charlie made a goal for me at Easter Road one day, and he was trying to play a 1-2. He thought he was going to get the ball back off me, but I was getting sick of it. I said, I was just sticking the net myself, you know. But Charlie was a brilliant player to play with, because the focus would be on him a lot, so I had more freedom, and vice versa. If I was playing well, I would have the focus on me, and then Charlie would hit 3 goals in. I scored 29 goals that season as well, and George McCluskey scored about 22 goals.
Must have been bad goalkeepers then.
We scored over 100 goals between the three forwards. And Dundee United won the league.
That was 82-83.
That was a brilliant season. We just scored goals for fun. Celtic fans love that. But again, they wouldn't invest. Roy Aiken, I love him. Great player, great pal. Never a sweeper. Was a brilliant midfield player, standing midfield player. Roy was a brilliant player. But Roy was never a sweeper. And with Tom McAdam, one of my best pals. Tom is the only guy I've ever heard apologising to forwards when they kicked him. You know what I mean? Nae centre half ever apologised to me, that's for sure.
When you played that period in the early 80s, when you played for Celtic, you've already mentioned Nicholas scoring 53 goals one season. You scored 26.
Oh, 26.
26. You also played alongside McClare and McCluskey and Nicholas. And when you
Mo Johnson as well.
Mo Johnson and Alan
McGarvey.
It's all right, whatever. We've mentioned them quite a few times on this podcast, so whatever, actually saying it. Nicholas McClure and McCluskey were all top goal scorers in Scotland when you played alongside them.
None of them could match Charlie for that 2 years. But I'll tell you, just before Charlie left, I noticed them drink a wee bit more, and they put on just a wee touch of weight. Charlie couldn't put on anyway. And I think when he went to Arsenal, the social life that he was living completely and utterly made him not the player he was at Celtic. Because, you know, he told me some of the things that was happening in London. I was like, oh my God, you know what I mean? He was going out to things all the time. And if you're a football player and you're near enough an alcoholic, you're going to be an alcoholic. Because even now, I go into pubs, Rangers fans even buy me a drink. And people say, Frank, great player, what do you want to drink? You know what I mean? Even now, I'm 61 now.
You're going to a pub and Rangers support. I wouldn't even done a pub with a Rangers supporter on it.
I'm not going to listen to all that. I've lived in Glasgow for 61 years. Yeah. I've lived in Glasgow.
A Peter Maranello,
you mean? I've got a lot of good pals with Rangers supporters, and I take drink after them. I can't be bothered. Oh, I can't do that.
Peter Maranello. Remember Peter Maranello, Jim? Superstar in Hibs. Milkman of British football. With Arsenal, he was the poster boy for milk. Went to Arsenal, just a complete flop. Just went to the boy just couldn't hack it.
The Rangers
couldn't hack it. And he came back to Hibs. He was just chatty. He was never the same player.
Talking about guys, your first goal for Celtic was
against
Hibs, and George Best played for Hibs that day.
George Best. I think whatever skill you've got something against you. And George Best was a genius, brilliant person, and you know, great to play. He played. I always remember he played in the semi-final in 1980 against Celtic. I think we won 4-1, and Dom Sullivan. I remember Dom saying, "I'm going to just do him right away," and ran out to do him. And George Best just put the ball through his leg and back. And I was so embarrassed for Dom that day. And after that, I said, "How did you get on with that first tackle, Dom?" After the game, we said,
So, Big Bully left, and Davy Hay then became the manager of Celtic. You've already mentioned Jim Melrose, who replaced you in the team for a wee while. What was your thought from that period?
Davy Hay didn't really like me. I went for a meal with Davy Hay, Davy Provin, and Jerry McNee, and a guy from Skye about 3 weeks ago. And I asked Davy, I said, why did you like me? I said, why did you let me go after I scored the one in the cup final? Talk about loyalty. Anyway, he said, I wanted to play Brian McClare up front with Mo Johnson. I said, why? You know, want me third? I said, I'll keep them going. He said, the big boy, what's his name?
Rambo McAnally.
McAnally. He said, I want him to be sub. I said, so you don't want me in the team at all? I said, I've just won the Scottish Cup final for you there and saved you getting losing your job. He said, that's it. And so I went away. Dundee United phoned me up on the Tuesday. Jim McLean phoned me up on the Tuesday, tried to sign me with Dundee United. I'd have went to Dundee United like that, because he had a brilliant defence. And again, to the final of a European competition. But I wanted to go to St Mammon to keep all my kids at school, because Jim McLean wanted me to go and live in Dundee.
May as well talk about my first ever cup final, which is 1985. What a day, fantastic day. What do you remember about that day?
I remember a few things. I remember Davey Proven over the free kick. I said, he can put this in, because Davey was a brilliant free kick taker. And that was a changing point in the game. So it was, once we scored that goal, then the fans just lit up and we just attacked. And Dundee United were the better team that day up to then. And then after that, we were the better team. And then I get the winner. They nearly scored at the end. Paul Stannard nearly scored at the end as well. So they were a very, very good team. And that was proved by them reaching the final of the European Cup Winners' Cup in 1987.
It's funny that you mentioned David Proven. At the game, I was sitting on the crush barrier and we got the free kick. My dad grabbed me and he says, David scored a goal exactly the same position a couple of weeks ago against Kilmarnock. He says, he's scoring here. And then he put it in, eh?
But that, these kids, see, fans sometimes, see, in the 85 Cup final, a roar went up with about 15 minutes to go before the game, the end of the game. What the fans roaring about? They're good people, and nothing like that. It's strange. And then I was doing the commentary in 1988, and Celtic were getting beat 1-0. I don't know if it was against Dundee United again. And then I was in commentary. If you go into that commentary, 15 minutes to go, I said, I had the same roar 2 years ago, or 3 years ago. And I said, and we went on to 1-2-1, and Celtic were getting beat 1-0 again. Frank McGarvey scored 2 goals. Amazing how supporters know things, how in your head you go, that's going to happen. And these guys have got so much knowledge of football. These guys are going to support their teams every week, that they know things like that. It's a strange thing.
It's the same as the cup final last year. I think when we got into the last 15 minutes and we were absolutely hammering Aberdeen, we knew it was only a matter of time before we were going to get that one.
And the fans seem to know that. I don't know why they know that.
We're just hopeless romantics.
I'm
You went back to St Mirren and you made your first return to Celtic October 1985 and you got an ovation for the jungle.
Right, see that game, I was ready to come off because I went over, I was all ready mentally for the game, I wanted to play well in the game, and then the Celtic fans started singing my name and I was walking over, I was coming off, I was going to come off because mentally I wasn't in a good state of mind to play in the game, and I wanted to come off, and I was that away if you just walking off the park and playing a sub before the game had even started. I was going to walk off and I played the game and I had no heart at all to play in the game. That's the only game I've ever played in my life that I've been like that. So it's not a bad idea, Celtic fans, if they want to get other players playing badly, it's to sing their name. Because I felt that day, the opposing supporters singing your name, the last thing you want to do is go up and score a few goals against them. My heart just dropped that day and I had a poor, very, very poor game just because of that.
We've done it at Love Street in 86 as well, we won the league.
I get the blame off Hearts. Hearts supporters are still giving me the blame. Sandy Clark was on a few years ago on Radio Clyde and they went, there was one of the two the St Mirren players not there that day. And I looked at that game, the Hearts game, and Sandy Clark never kicked the ball. And I rang up Radio Clyde. I said to Sandy, I want to talk to Sandy Clark. I said, Sandy, said I wasn't there. I said, that's your opinion. I said, and where were you that day? I said, I'll tell you where you were. You were nowhere to be seen. You bottled it. And that's why Hearts lost the league, because you bottled it. Nothing to do with anybody else.
Celtic overran you in the first half that day, yeah?
Celtic were, once they got the first goal, they were magnificent. And the fans were there, and they cheered them on. And there was nine. That day, I'll tell you a story nobody knows about that day. Jim Stewart was the goalkeeper. No, Campbell Murray was a goalkeeper. Let me finish. I've not finished my story yet. Campbell Money was the goalkeeper that day, and Jim Stewart liked his grub. He was eating a few steak pies and that upstairs at 2 o'clock, and Campbell Money said to Alec Muller, I'm sick, I can't play in this game. I think he bottled that way, but that's only my opinion. And Jim Stewart had to come in, and he was told at 2:15 that he had to play, and I think he was on his, it was at least his second steak pie was on, but I think he had the two of them. And then at 2:30 that day, we're all sitting and we're all going to go for it, and then Jim Stewart was sick over the toilet. He was completely sick over the toilet. He didn't really want it. He shouldn't have played that, but we never had a third goalkeeper, so he had to play. He was a Rangers supporter, and 9 of the St Mirren players that day were Rangers supporters, so I don't think anybody can say
it changed.
I don't think anybody can say that it was because of Celtic players that Celtic just, once they got the first goal, that was it. They had the players to finish it off. That was that simple as that.
Nah, it was a fun, I was at Love Street that day, and it was a brilliant first half. Then the second half's a bit of a non-event, and I always remember like an eerie silence developing as the game was going on, and then Celtic get the corner.
There was a roar went up,
and the roar went up, and you were all looking about, you know, what's going on? And I just remember the bedlam after that. Were you on the pitch at that point? Were you still?
I was on the pitch.
Did you know what was going on, or just?
I knew every at that time when I was younger. I knew every player in Scottish football, where they all played, what position, everything. I knew everything, and if a noise came right away in the park, I knew there was a goal for somebody else. I knew all these things right away as soon as it happened when I was on the park.
Did you feel like celebrating with the Celtic players?
Well, the champagne. I thought the champagne in Celtic dressing room after the game could have been better.
Your time at Celtic, 2 league titles, 2 Scottish Cups and a League Cup, 245 appearances, 113 goals. Would you change anything?
I would change nothing. I played, people say to me right now, this is the time to play, and it is, they're making fortunes. I never made any money, just enough to pay my mortgage, pay for the family's food for the week and everything else. At that time, we had to win a trophy at the end of the season. You get a good holiday. In the 85 Cup final, went up to Grosvenor. After that, all the players' wives are all kissing me and all that, but I went, not because of fancy me then, because they were going on a holiday that year. I know you're all shocked at that, but that, ask any player for that time. My time at Celtic was the most fantastic time in my whole life. Never regret anything I've done on the park or off the park. Everything I've done was for the sake of Celtic. I loved my time there. I loved under Billy McNeil and David Hay. I loved all the supporters. The supporters, the jungle especially, I love, because they made me a better player. They definitely made me a better player, and they were always worth an extra man in every single game. And I love playing for Celtic and everything about Celtic. I love the way Celtic were formed to help the people of Glasgow. I love all that. I love everything about Celtic. The jungle, I would love to see the jungle getting back. I think it's badly missed, and they could make a big place there and get the jungle back. There's no doubt about that. And that would really, really be a brilliant thing for Celtic. And I would love that to happen.
Thanks, Frank. You made my formative years watching Celtic very, very happy. Thanks
very
much.
Thank you
very much. I must away now. I can no longer tarry. This morning's tempest I have to cross. I must be guided without a stumble into the arms I love the most. And when he came to his true love's dwelling, down gently upon a stone, and through her window he's whispered.
true love are within at home. Wake up, love, it is thine own true lover. Wake up, love, and let me in. For I am tired, love, and oh so weary, and more than need drenched to the skin. She's raised her off her down soft pillow. She's raised her up and she's let him in. And they were locked in each other's arms until that long night was past and gone. And when that long night was past and over, and when the small clouds began to grow, he's taken her hand and they've kissed and parted. Then he saddled and mounted and away did go. I must away now, I can no longer tarry. This morning's tempest I have to cross. I must be guided without a stumble into the arms I love the most.
A big thank you to Frank McGarvey for taking the time to be a guest at our event and for chatting to A Celtic State of Mind. The music you heard during the show was Negative Vibes by the incredible Damien Dempsey and the Night Visiting song by the Dubliners. There is also a powerful version of that song by Damo on his Rocky Road album, which I'd highly recommend. A Celtic State of Mind's previous 31 episodes can be accessed by searching iTunes, Spreaker or your pre-installed podcast player. Make sure to subscribe and you won't miss our upcoming episodes, which include former players, Madchester icons, documentary directors, actors, and someone who played a pivotal role in Fergus McCann's takeover 24 years ago. You can keep up to date with us on Twitter at Paul Dykes, at A Northern Prose, and at the CQN Podcast. And I must take this opportunity to thank you all for listening and downloading the show. Feel free to leave your comments on iTunes and Spreaker, or just tweet us directly. Join us again next week, where we'll be back alongside another special guest with A Celtic State of Mind. But until then, keep the faith.